I am on a mission back to the plane. There's a road over here that I'll be able to walk on here shortly, but there's nothing for miles.
I've been meaning to make this video for a while. I aborted a takeoff on a desert dirt strip last October during a canyoneering trip with some friends. If you know Utah, you probably don't know Hanksville, Utah, unless you're a pilot or spend a lot of time in the canyons. It's sort of in the middle of nowhere, Utah. And 3 miles from Hanksville on dirt, back roads, middle of nowhere, is this Angels Point landing strip and No Man's Canyon. It's embarrassing is the right word, but nobody wants to crash an airplane. And certainly in the moment, I remember just thinking like, I am like crashing my airplane purposefully right now, you know, in this aborted takeoff. Like, so that, you know, lots of like weird emotions. Luckily, in my case, like it turned out to be a great learning experience. It very easily could have resulted in death, like straight up. With that, enjoy. Let me know if there's questions or things that, you know, I maybe omitted in the raw edit here, but I hope it's helpful and maybe even entertaining for you.
Just got dropped off on the side of this dirt road, middle of nowhere. We're gonna go retrieve a GoPro off the side of a couple cliffs with 4 different ropes. How many feet of rope do we have? We have 1 270-foot rope and 1 or 2 60-foot ropes.
Yeah, like 70-ish.
I'm ditching and I'm not responsible for their deaths.
It's gonna be kind of serious. We'll see how it works out. So we're currently scouting how we get from here off this bluff, down this, over this. We could walk down this, and the goal is to get into this ravine, probably down through here. There's a 150-foot rappel straight down in here.
At the end of this canyon, try to show a clip of this kind of right here, but I left the GoPro at the end of that last rappel.
And we'd get back to the plane, which is over here, and we'd basically ascend back up this and ascend our rope and then just walk back. So it's gonna be interesting. So these guys just anchored off of this rock right there, which is solid. And we're now doing a line test to see if this 60 meter rope gives us the length we need to get down to the next ledge.
Oh shit.
Yeah. We're rocks, we're hugging the wall, so I just made it down. Brian's already down here.
Yeah.
We're and Adam's here. Coming, if you can see him way up there. And there's just a lot of loose scroll up there, so we're just keeping. We're just ducking out of the way here. Nice, Adam.
Woo. Woo.
All right, so next plan is when I made the first video, we're standing right up there. So now we're gonna walk down this, right over to here. We're gonna come down here. Tori's already down over that scouting. And then the big 150-foot rappel is right down in there, which is where the GoPro is, which is the whole point of this mission. So that's the next basically drop somewhere down into that hole.
Hang.
Hell yeah.
It's badass. It's badass.
Fuck yeah.
The rope is on the ground. It's badass.
Oh, that looked like a good overhang. Hell yeah. GoPro is recovered. I can actually hear people up there, which is gnarly. They have no idea I'm down here, but that's where we rappelled from. I think they're like probably 2 puddles back. So there's no way they're gonna hear me or see me, but I hear them. Sick. I'm almost back, and this is a pretty epic view of, you can't see the rope in the film, but right there through that little spout is where the rope's hanging, and that is where we're going to be ascending back up. So it'll be kind of interesting to see how long that takes to ascend back up.
as pilot in command, the plan was to fly out that night. And in the morning of that same day, one person had driven, bringing two people. So originally there was a total of five of us. And one of the people who had driven wanted to fly back. So that morning before all of this canyon stuff on the second day, I had done a new weight and balance calculation where I, you know, took a human life and exchanged that human life for a bunch of weight. And all of that weight was, you know, cold weather camping gear, tents, sleeping bags, eating utensils, basically anything that wasn't required to canyoneer. The only thing that we had on us was ropes and harnesses, carabiners. And I had weighed all of those before the trip. I had weighed out like ropes and beaners and all those things to just have like a pretty clear idea of like how much was I carrying and weight. And then because this place was so remote, coming into it, I had a lot of water weight.
So here we are. Boom, look at that. So we'll be going all the way back up. This will give good perspective of how steep this is. So, boom. It's gotta be like 150 feet, I think.
Oh,
man. That is so sick. Tori's a little more than halfway up. Adam's getting me set up here. You can see. This is what my foot will be going into. This here is going to be my ascender with my hand. So I'm basically going to be hoisting up with one hand and then lifting up with my foot, something like that. All right, quick GoPro. Looking down at Brian. He's got my fireman. Amazing view. Not that far to go if you're looking up. I've got to be at least 120 feet off the ground. Anyways, I'm tired. I still got a lot of work. But enjoy the view. You got that?
The cord? That cord that you use, do they need that?
We should send the whole setup. Okay. So just all of this, throw that in there. Oh my gosh, I just made it up, detached. Probably sending down the rope, and I'm gonna get some water. That was a lot of work.
Hands down for an epic job, keeping us safe. Friend Adam, who planned the trip, and Tori, who's a firefighter out of Salt Lake City. Both of them, you know, it was intense.
All right, so we got the ropes cleaned up, and we just buckling my backpack back up. We climbed up this, disconnected from down there, and then now we're basically going a little bit back down and then back up that little line there, cut over, and then Tori's up at that next rappel, hopefully already ascending up it, and then we will be home free to the airplane. Little natural staircase is nice. So we got eyes on Tori right there. He's just getting to the top of the next one. And he led the last one. It's probably the hardest part. Where have we been? What have we done? Where are we going?
So we've been in No Man's Canyon. We flew in a little earlier. But we left the GoPro, and so we dropped in at the end of the canyon.
I left the GoPro.
We did a couple rappels down in here. Epic rappels. And overhung just really good stuff.
Yeah.
And
Adam, our fearless leader.
Now we're coming back out.
I'm a fearful tag along.
I don't know, I'm following you.
Going where no man has been before.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're just getting to the bottom of this last ascent, which was our first rappel. So here we are. So what he's setting up before when we were doing it, at when you descend, there's some slack that this gets loosened when you're pulling yourself up. So we get this cross-loaded like this. So he's gonna set up a second anchor device, so that if something were to happen because of that cross-loading, we have a second anchor.
Safety first.
Thank you. We got our bag ropes down here, weighted, so when Adam goes up, he can more easily move his foot thing up. This is the foot device. Taking a quick break. I am so close to the top. Adam's looking up at me. Oh my gosh. Sunset. Dude, sunset's about gone. We gotta hurry.
That was, you know, 150 feet each way straight up, you know, just ascending ourselves up the rope, epic footage and just an intense, tiring day. So by the time we got to the top of the second route, I'll show some of that footage now. We were tired. I mean, it was a full day, like figuring all that out and then ascending up the rope and the heat. I mean, it was hot, it was sweaty.
Oh, I just got to the top. This is the top. Now I'm racing back to get the plane prepared.
So that's the situation. We're coming to the top of this second route, and it was basically, you know, pushing daylight. We'd made the gear swap.
Those guys are gonna help Adam up, pull the rope, clean the rope. Depending on one versus the other, I don't know, I'll have to see when I get there, but I need to inspect the runway. One has a big mound over the, like right in the middle of it. I need about 1200 feet to take off just because of how we're loaded.
I'd mentioned there was two runways, one with the Camelback, which we landed on coming in from the west. And then the other runway runs sort of north to south.
So here I am, runway option number one, planes all the way down there in the distance. I'm just gonna walk up here a little bit because it's kind of like a bump, and what I'm thinking, this is what I'm walking up right now. All of this right here, there's a slight slope to it. So my thought is that I can actually come up here, and there's plenty of room to, it's tight, but there's plenty of room to turn around. And then, oh yeah, there's like, if you can see, and probably light's not good, but there's a little hump right there. So I definitely want to be on this side of that hump, but anywhere right here. And I think we should be pretty good. The runway kind of turns a little bit, but should be able to stay corrected with rudder, and then I'll be able to pick up plenty of speed for the takeoff. And anyways, now I'm gonna go drop these bags at the plane, start prepping the plane, and then go check out runway number two. But I'm looking over here to see if I can see them at all, and I can't. So
the runway that ran south to north to me seemed like the best runway to take off on relative to my aircraft, and it just seemed the smoothest. And you know, I looked on Google Maps and kind of calculated, I knew it was going to be a short field takeoff, right? But I'd kind of calculated based on the hump, like, and chose the runway that I felt gave me the maximum runway distance, which
if I do the one with the mound, might be close. If I do the other one, I have plenty of runway. And based on the daylight, amazing sunset, I'll probably want to do the second one.
I'd calculated to be somewhere around like 12 to 1300 feet, probably, you know, having now done it like 1200 feet, if that, because the south side of the runways like kind of starts to like be relatively steep and pretty rocky. So that cut down on my runway distance. And I wouldn't have been able to necessarily know or see that without having been there on site.
Finally back to the plane. So I'm gonna get it loaded up, pack up Tori's stuff, and then we'll be good to go.
By the time they got to the plane, I already felt rushed. Like it had already crossed my mind, like I'm rushed, like I'm rushing. Daylight, we're rushing as a team. They're rushing to clean the route, to come and meet me at the airplane. We were rushed. And, you know, one of like the basic lessons that you're taught, you know, in getting your private pilot's license is, you know, don't external factors, like don't take off, you know, when there are external factors influencing your environment, right? And that 100% was the case at this point. I had still technically gone through everything that that a pilot is supposed to go through with regards to calculations and weight and balance and pre-flight and all the checklist, right? All of that. I had done all of that, but I had done it rushed. I didn't skip any steps. I just did it rushed. So that was the situation as everybody's like getting into the airplane and I'm starting it up and we're putting all of the gear. And the other factor that I was conscious of at this point in time was weight and balance. Like I said, I'd done the calculations. I felt comfortable with the situation, you know, with the weight and balance specifically. But I knew I was heavy, and that was just something where it was like, you know, I'd done the math and done the calculations. I just knew I was heavy, and I didn't necessarily like that. I just didn't like it enough to feel or believe that it was a risk to flight. And so I moved forward, but just, you know, knowing that was a factor. And so we started up the plane, taxied, as you know, to my, I'd walked the strip. So I had this point on the strip and where I was like, okay, that's the point, you know, that gives me maximum runway distance that I could, you know, do my turnaround. That's where I was going to pre-flight. So we taxied there, did a complete pre-flight again, like I was rushed, like it was getting darker. Well, and you can see from the video by the time I was actually on the roll, I think the video makes it look darker than it was, but it was dark. It was like 7:07:05 p.m. when I was taking off. That was in October. So I think sunset was 7 p.m. if I remember correctly. Anyways, so did the pre-flight again. Went through all the checklist items, but I was rushed. And I remember thinking like, I'm rushed, but I'm like doing everything. And so I kept moving forward. And then we get on the roll, and a couple of things that I was just conscious of, there was zero wind. Like, I don't mean there wasn't like a breeze, like there was absolute calm. Absolute desert calm, like just zero wind. And I remember thinking, especially with, you know, the short filled strip and my weight, I remember thinking, man, I wish there was at least even like a crosswind, like I would even take like a moderate crosswind, but there was just zero wind. I remember thinking that. And this was, you know, before I'm on the roll, just running through all of kind of your pre-flight sort of calculations when you're weighted on a desert dirt strip with three souls on board. I'm, you know, I, I took the time to manage my pilot and command responsibilities as best as I, could. So yeah, pre-flight's done, turned around, I throttle up, and, now I'm on the roll. And first thing I remember, again, it's dark, so I wish that I had better panel visibility. This particular Cessna 210, you often, once you're full power on the roll, you even after you adjust your mixture for the density altitude, you often have to just slightly adjust it in those first like couple hundred feet, 100 feet, to get full RPMs. And I don't think that I did that. And one of the reasons why is because, and this kind of goes back to just being rushed and then not giving myself, it's like the most basic things in piloting, but one, external factors, and then two, personal minimums. Okay. I had mentioned that it was like a 1200 foot strip. By my calculations, I needed 1,000 feet. And here I am like in the video here saying that, in the first like 100 to 200 feet, like sometimes you have to adjust the fuel ratio mixture. So basically like I didn't give myself enough margin of error relative to my weight and balance. The plane had enough power for sure to take off in this distance and do it with the weight and balance, but just with zero air. And so I don't remember adjusting that fuel ratio mixture because of a number of things. One, short field takeoff on dirt, new environment with flaps. And I think all of our ropes and then the people in the cockpit, everything sounded different. Like I think the ropes dampened the sound in the cockpit. And so there, as I was taking off, it was noticeably like different than taking off, even like landing the aircraft the day previously, just because of the environment. And so, in that first 25% of the 1200 foot strip, I'm noticing like this sounds different. I'm noticing that, I'm trying to pay attention, make sure that I'm like on the strip, because it was a skinnier strip and, it's rocky and dirt, so there was that factor. And then I'm noticing the wind, because, within that first 25% of the runway, the very first thing where I was like, this is not right. My airspeed didn't come alive as quickly as normal, right? So, and so I'm now thinking like, okay, well, zero wind, and I'm doing short field takeoff. So I'm all the way back on the stick. I'm 20% on flaps. And so I'm thinking to myself, okay, no wind, no airspeed indicator. I clearly am in, creating purposefully additional drag with, full ailerons and then 28 degrees flap. So I'm thinking, okay, well, let's see where I'm at 50% down the runway, right? And my mind is just clicking through it, because at this point, I'm back, 50 knots, I wouldn't have been 50 knots. I was probably 40 knots. And my rotation speed in this aircraft is 60 knots. I wanted 70, but one of the things I learned from the FAA investigator, which was kind of cool, is that I put this together before, but VR is calculated at gross weight, which I would have been at or slightly under. And so 60 knots should have been, my appropriate rotate speed, especially with 20 degrees flap. So I was probably halfway down the runway around like 40 knots, something like that. The airspeed had just barely come alive. At that point, I remember having this thought. There was a basically like, 100, 200 foot bluff, 300 yards off the end of this strip. And so my thought was like, well, if I can get into ground effect, then, I've got plenty of room for air to ascend and drop my flaps and cruise off. At that point, once that thought had kind of like run its course, I'm 75% down the strip. I'm approaching. It was the weirdest thing, because like when you're flying, like you want to fly, like you've done everything to put the plane in the air, and your intuition is not to ground the aircraft. Your intuition is to fly the aircraft, right? And you're taught when you're flying, fly the aircraft, right? That's like rule number one, fly the aircraft. And so I knew of a point on the strip that I had in my mind where it was just like, okay, that's my point. And if I pass that point and I'm not in ground effect, like I'm not flying the aircraft. And shortly thereafter, I hit that point, and that's where it was like, wait, but I still want to pull up. And it was like, no, that's my point. Pulled the throttle, and so you can see here in the video, I would have been right there at VR slightly. I must have been slightly under, probably plus or minus 5 knots, but clearly wasn't in ground effect. Pulled the throttle and, you know, made a planer people decision. That was at the end of the day, I was like, okay, planer people, what am I going to risk? Plane, pulled the throttle, and you know, that area, once you're off the strip, it's just a bunch of really, really soft, silty dirt and sagebrush. So you can see us kind of just like plowing through this soft dirt, and then we were almost stopped, you know, probably 15 knots at this point. And the front nose gear, and if you know Cessna 210, the gear saddles are not the most robust. They're not designed for desert dirt strip, you know, like that soft, silty dirt and sagebrush. So we're almost, and again, that was another pilot error. The front nose gear collapsed, prop, you know, hit the ground. You can see some pictures of the aftermath here. These are the same pictures that I took that night right after the incident. So it probably would have been 7:30-ish PM that I sent to NTSB, basically confirm with authorities the incident.
Yeah.
Fuck, yeah. And that's our shit.
I figured we should do like a little
fireside
chat of the of the unfolding of the last hour.
Yep.
So
we're live.
We're alive.
Yep.
I think the last thing that I commented on here was basically me like checking out, like walking the landing strip.
Oh, okay.
One of the things that was kind of cool with the people that I was with, you know, they're very similar, like risk analysis and planning decisions that, you know, were required during our 2 days of intensive canyoneering that go into planning and taking off from a desert dirt strip. To their credit, they did a better job than I in this situation. But what was cool is after the incident, everybody remained so calm. And I appreciated that as the pilot. Everybody was calm, collected, and on their own, totally self-initiated, you know, jumped into some sort of action that was beneficial for, you know, us as a community, right? No cold weather gear, dark, middle of nowhere. One person had cell phone service. My first call, the very first thing that I used the cell phone for, was to call NTSB. That was my first response. I think that was a good decision. From there on out, it was, I mean, I had to have talked, there was probably like four or five different people I spoke with that evening, from like NTSB to FAA to FAA investigator. I mean, they were quick, which was impressive, I thought. Search and rescue is who ended up coming to pick us up. Took them like 3.5 hours to pick us up. The mayor of Hanksville was part of that team, which I thought was kind of cool. Amazing search and rescue crew down there. So if there any of them are watching this, like, I was really impressed. Everything, like their attitude. This was like a Sunday evening.
New update. We're just here with a search and rescue, and you can see them out there. Oh my gosh. All you can see is like a faint light, but they're out there taking pictures of the plane, just to document like what happened. So the saga continues.
So, I mean, these guys are volunteers coming, like leaving their families to go, you know, they have no idea what. I had sent pictures. I had given like 3 or 4 different reports that there was no injuries or scratches or anything like that, that damage was relatively minor. You can see that from the pictures. When those guys showed up 3.5 hours after the fact, they had no idea. For all they knew, they were going to find body parts and death. They knew nothing, which I think is crazy that, you know, in 2021, like our like search and rescue and, you know, police and fire, like don't have a communication tool that's synced. I think from like a tax dollar perspective alone, like there's probably hundreds, millions of dollars annually that could be saved just by properly communicating between departments. But anyways, that was my only complaint. But as far as the individuals that showed up, like totally like stellar high-class individuals. And 3.5 hours though, so we had to make like a little cowboy campfire to kind of keep us warm. We huddled around that. You know, I did have like, I actually used in the plane, like, everybody should have like just basic amenities, some spare water. You know, we always kept a blanket. We had a few other just like random things that it's, you know, flashlights, obviously, like stuff like that, where it's like, just in case, you know. And yeah, this was my like, just in case excuse to use that stuff. And I did, like that blanket actually was, you know, what kept me from shivering to death.
All right, so we're coming up on the plane. Search and rescue is getting their pictures. It's kind of cool to have it lit up in its sad state. I guess they're done, so we'll start walking back.
You know, it's crazy. So that was in October, and here we are now in March, and it was only like a month ago that I wanted to wait until like FAA and everybody, like I went through their entire process before posting anything, just because, like, you know, I wanted to make sure that like I was doing it right. And also like as a pilot, like learning from the experience and making sure that like I was sort of first improving myself as a pilot, especially as a commercial pilot, like I'm flying other people for hire or for free, for fun like this. This was just for fun. That process with the FAA, like applause to them, because they did the most thorough investigation. Like luckily there was no death in this case, which I think like to their credit allows them to garner a lot more information about like what went wrong, right? Because their goal is to save and preserve life and to make pilots better. And 100% like they did that in this case. I don't know how many random people I spoke with between October and I don't know, say like January, February, just and random calls at random times of day from random people from different, like this organization, that organization, insurance, FAA, like an investigator here, a pilot, you know, an FAA, like pilot responder there, just sometimes kind of like kind of coming at it from an interrogation perspective, like it, not interrogation, but like in the same way that like when you do a flight review and you know, you just, you're expected to be on your A game. You know, you're a pilot, you're being issued like a government license to fly planes and fly other people in that plane. And so, you know, do like, are you capable of that? Are you proficient? You know, do you truly understand, like, you know, the responsibility that you're taking on? So that's what I mean by like an interrogation. And then in this case, obviously, like either something malfunctioned on the plane, which was not the case, or like the pilot made a mistake, which was the case in this situation. And, you know, they really want to draw that out, but they also want to make sure that if there was something that went wrong on the airplane, you know, that they can note that, issue an STC or, you know, whatever is necessary to make sure that it does not happen to, you know, other people. I mean, they take that seriously. Like the carbon monoxide sensor, I believe, is one that's going to be required here soon, because there's been 32 deaths since roughly, I think, 1982, something like that, which is not that many deaths, you know, in that large period of time that's attributable to a single thing, you know, carbon monoxide poisoning in the cockpit. But FAA takes that stuff seriously, and it's a relatively inexpensive thing to prevent one more death. And, you know, that's it's either in effect or coming into effect. The FAA does a good job of keeping people safe, I think, but still allowing freedoms that we're able to experience as general aviation pilots. So kudos to them. And then for me as the pilot, a phenomenal learning experience. General aviation, I think, like, you're always learning as a pilot, and you're always learning from other pilots, and you're always looking to share or teach something to your fellow pilots, because it makes you a better pilot, and in return, everybody uplifts because of that. That's why I'm making this video. So this is the story. Hopefully this is helpful for other people. There's a lot of backcountry pilots in Utah. Yeah, look forward to being back in the air here soon.
Yeah, one sec now. Let me, one of us needs to get in first. So let me get in.